I'm a Canadian distiller making spirits in England. This is David, one of my bosses here. He's a distiller here at the Shakespeare Distillery. I'm very excited to announce that we'll be starting a new series on this channel about our rum making process at the distillery. This should be exciting, eh, David?
Very.
Since neither of us have any experience making rum. Anyways, will you do the honors?
Let's go.
It's 9 a.m. at the Shakespeare Distillery, and the lorry driver is here to deliver our 5 tons of molasses. As you can see, everyone is really excited about it. We're all out here to see the IBCs getting filled with blackstrap molasses. The molasses is warm, around 25 to 30 degrees Celsius when it enters the lorry tanks. At that temperature, the consistency is like water, so it's easy to move from container to container. The lorry driver is telling us a story about the time he delivered molasses somewhere and told someone to hold on to the hose like David is doing right now. The person didn't hold on tight enough and the hose flew out of his hands and sprayed molasses everywhere. This molasses is from the Tate & Lyle sugar refinery in London, and the lorry driver said he delivers the same molasses to BrewDog. So it sounds like it's a very good base material to start from. The IBCs are filling very quickly with the molasses. Since the molasses is warm, it takes less than 10 minutes to fill a 1,000-liter IBC. Now we'll just wheel in our 4 IBCs full of molasses. Look at David flexing those biceps. The molasses is in, so we're going to go ahead and do some more small-scale rum experiments with this molasses. Let me just take a sample of the molasses and we'll head off to the gin schoolroom to play with it. Before this, David had previously done 30 small rum experiments with molasses, but it was from a different supplier. So the quality of that molasses was very low. It had a bitter taste to it, and I think there were a lot of unfermentable sugars in it as well. Unfermentable sugars are sugars that cannot be fermented by the yeast. In other words, the yeast is unable to convert those sugars into alcohol. So the more unfermentable sugars there are in the molasses, the less alcohol will be produced. This new molasses is better tasting and is sweet, so we're hoping it will produce a better tasting rum as well. Before, David was using a refractometer to measure the starting sugar content of the molasses wort. The refractometer works based on the idea that light passing through a small sample of wort will refract the light at different angles based on the concentration of dissolved sugar in the wort. So depending on how much sugar is in the wort, the angle of light refraction will change and give us different readings. This is okay to do a fast initial reading, but things get difficult as soon as the fermentation starts, since there's now alcohol in the liquid as well as sugar. Since he had no other measurement devices at the time, David used the refractometer to measure the liquid before the fermentation started and after it ended, and then use that data, which was in bricks, to calculate how much alcohol was produced from the fermentation. We can't trust those numbers since the refractometer isn't accurate enough on its own. Luckily, we now have more than the refractometer to use. Our new iStill fermenter comes with a tilt sensor, so we can use this to take our measurements with. And the tilt sensor will give us the specific gravity of the liquid. Next, we'll pour out 100 milliliters of molasses and see how much that weighs. With that information, we can calculate how many liters of molasses we'll need to make up 4.6 liters of our molasses wort. So of the previous 30 small rum experiments David did, there was one in particular that we really liked during the taste test. So in this next set of experiments, we're going to replicate that previous test batch. Once we've weighed out the molasses, we'll measure out the water needed to make 4.6 liters of molasses wort at 14 bricks. Here are little plastic jugs, aka our makeshift fermenters. Then we're going to slowly add citric acid to get it down to a pH between 3.5 and 4. We needed 75% less citric acid to bring down the pH compared to the previous test batches using the molasses from the different supplier. This is good news since it means we won't have to buy as much citric acid to lower the pH. The reason we're trying to lower the pH, or in other words, make the wort more acidic, is because we like the flavors that the yeast produces during fermentation in this more acidic environment. I'll pitch in the dried baker's yeast, and pitching in the yeast just means we're adding the yeast in. That's just the special term for it. Fun fact, that dried baker's yeast that you buy in the grocery store is produced on a nutrient source which is rich in sugar, which is usually molasses. That's why you'll see a lot of home distillers turn to baker's yeast when they're making rum. Now David, being the resourceful man that he is, bought these aquarium heaters to maintain the fermentation at the right temperature. We'll set the fermentation to the mid-30s, and then we'll pop our lid and our airlock on. Our airlock is this funny little plastic device with water sitting inside it. So during the fermentation, the yeast will eat up the sugars in our molasses wort and convert them into alcohol. Carbon dioxide gas will also be released during this fermentation process. The carbon dioxide will go up and into this airlock. The pressure from the carbon dioxide will build up and build up until it pushes through the water in the airlock, causing the water to burp or bubble during the fermentation as the carbon dioxide escapes to relieve the pressure inside the vessel. So a very active fermentation will also be very noisy since you can hear the carbon dioxide gas escaping through the airlock. What we don't want is for air to get into our fermentation. So the water inside the airlock will help stop air from the surrounding area, which isn't pressurized, from getting into our fermentation. So carbon dioxide is able to leave our fermentation vessel, but air is unable to get inside the vessel, which is exactly what we want. David will seal up the top with this plaster gun, which I think is a little bit extreme, but it gets the job done. And he's sealing it up tight to make sure that no air can enter the fermentation through here, and that the carbon dioxide can only leave through the airlock. Great. We'll pop that on the table and plug in our aquarium heater, and we're all set. For this first test batch, we have 4.6 liters. We've set the pH between 3.5 and 4. We have starting bricks of 14 and a temperature in the mid-30s. And we've pitched in dried baker's yeast. Every day of the fermentation, we'll come in and shake the fermentation vessel for 30 seconds to make sure everything is mixed. Now we'll continue by preparing the other two test fermentations. Here are the statistics for our second fermentation. Everything is the same as the first one, except we will not shake the fermentation vessel every day. In our third fermentation, everything is the same as the first one, except we'll rehydrate the baker's yeast in some warm water for 15 minutes before pitching it into the fermentation vessel. Now we'll leave our three rum fermentations to bubble away, and we'll check back on them each day.
Well, I hope you enjoyed watching the start of our rum production journey. In the next video, we'll be getting our fermenter ready for the large-scale rum production. So in the meantime, please give this video a thumbs up and hit the subscribe button for more distilling and distilling videos. This is Brewbird.
And David, sending you good vibes until the next video.
Bye.
I have too many words.
Okay. I think that was passable. That was passable, right?
I think so, yeah.
Okay. 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 I can't. It's so hard to do this with you sitting here.
I'm sorry.
Well, I hope you enjoyed seeing us at this one more time.